Hey guys, how's everyone doing tonight? It's good. What? That's good. Good to see you brothers here tonight. I want to welcome you to Thursday Study. Welcome any of you who are tuning in through their computers. It's good to have you watching with us. And we're just going to open in prayer, lift up some requests to the Lord tonight. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your presence, Lord. And we do pray that you would have your way here tonight, Lord. And we lift up these requests from the brothers, Father. And we lift it up believing, Father, you hear these prayers, Lord, and you do answer our heart's cry, Father. Brother Tim, he wants to lift up his wife for her return to the Lord. So we pray for her, Diana, right now, Father, that you would just turn her heart back to you, Lord. Tim loves his wife and would love to see her in fellowship with you, Father. So we just pray for that. Lord, we want to lift up our brother Matt Bandy and his family. His brother John has gone to be with you, Lord, today. And we know that we rejoice that he's with you, Father. We know that there's also sadness. So we lift up Matt and his family, Father, as they mourn the loss of John, Father. But also rejoice knowing that he's in your hands, Father God. We just pray you just comfort their hearts, Father, as they miss him. Our brother Renee wants to lift up his sister-in-law, Linda, the stomach cancer. We just pray for healing for her, Father. Just continue to have your hand upon her, Lord. We pray for how her body handles any drugs and treatment, Lord. We just pray for giving her peace and strength and just to help her feel your presence, Father, throughout this ordeal, Lord, and just not be discouraged, knowing that your hand is upon her. Also, Lord, we want to lift up our brother Ed Jeffers. We just pray for him, Father. We just pray that you just give him peace and joy in spite of his circumstances, Father, that you give him strength, that you would just raise him up out of that sick bed, Father, that you would allow him to speak again, Father, and to walk, Lord, if that be your will. We just pray, Father, that he would feel your presence and know that you're with him, comforting him, Father. Well, lift up our brother Mike Martin and healing from this spider bite that's been infected. 4 days in the hospital and still daily antibiotics and still dealing with this, Lord. It's hard to believe an insect like that can wreak havoc now in our bodies, Father. But we just praise you, Father, our brother Mike. He's just so willing to just give you the glory in all things, Lord. But we do want to lift him up. We just pray for this infection, that it would just go away completely, Father. Take away any swelling and pain that he's dealing with at the moment. And, Lord, you want to lift up our brother Tony Amara and his family, Lord, as still unaware of the whereabouts of his brothers in Burkina Faso that have been kidnapped, Lord. Due to the political unrest out there, we just pray that he can get in touch with them, get some information on them, Father God. We pray for protection on all those that were kidnapped by the terrorists, Lord. We pray for peace in that country, Father. We just pray for order and peace in the country that's just reeking with the havoc and turmoil at the moment, Father God, and total unrest, Lord. We just pray, Father, that your hand would be upon that country, Lord, that people would come to know you, Father, and that you would give those people peace. But right now, we just pray for peace in our brother Tony's heart, Father, as he desires to know the whereabouts and status of his family, Lord. And Father, again, we just thank you for your presence here tonight, and we pray you have your way. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Again. 1 John 4, we're doing tonight. 1 John, John's epistles. All right, really quickly. Remember, John wrote his gospel, then he wrote the epistles, and then he wrote Revelation. All of them just maybe 10 years before the turn, these three were written by the turn of the century. So John was, what he was dealing with, let's go back and review real quick, what he was dealing with was the church in Ephesus that he had been kind of teaching at and pastoring it. They were struggling. And it's just like a lot of churches do. They start well, and, you know, even as us as Christians, we start well, and then all of a sudden we stop doing the things we need to do. We forget how important it was to do these things. And so John is writing to them and going back over some ideas, because what happens is not only do we lose our mole, what happens is here come the sharks. They're looking for something to eat. And the world is always hungry to destroy other people. And so John's aware of that. He's writing to them. And what a blessed man John was, because he was the one that Jesus loved, you know. And I think that's the way we should all feel about it. We should all feel like we're the one that Jesus loves. It's important. So let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your word, because, Lord, it's our light. It's what guides us. We ask you, Lord, to just give us a recharge our batteries, get us going again, let us get deep into your word, and Lord, just trusting just that, Lord, you're speaking through it, that Jesus is the living word of God, and what you've given us is the written word of God. This is your heart, Lord. Speak to us. We thank you and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, anyway, in John's gospel, there's five basic parts of this chapter. It's 21 verses. But John is writing here about the love of Jesus. He's reminding them. And it says, first of all, one of the headings would be love for God and one another. Then the next section is knowing God through love, seeing God through love, the consummation of love, and obedience by faith. And it depends upon the translation that you have as to how they'll break it up, what it will be, what they will give the heading to. But we finished off 1 John 3 last week. Verse 23, and this is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of the Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment. Now, he who keeps his commandments, abides in him, and he in him. And by this we know that he abides in us by the Spirit whom he has given us. And this is really important to understand this. We've been given the Spirit of God. We've been given the Spirit of God. Why? Because the commandments were there, but they could not affect the change. We need God in us giving us direction. It needs to be in our heart, in our life, and to love him. And this is what John is pointing out in this epistle. And we're going to read the verses 1 through 6 first. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. They are of the world, therefore they speak as of the world, and the world hears them. We are of God. He who knows God hears us, and he who is not of God does not hear us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. This is an important thing, and I think it's really hard as a young Christian to realize that the Spirit of God came to dwell in us. Father sent the Son to reveal the Father, and then when he was taken back into heaven, he says, I'm going to send you the Comforter. And when he was being talked to, he said, well, I must go, because if I don't go, the Comforter will not come. The Spirit was moving, but it was taking on a new relationship. The Spirit now was going to come and dwell in men's hearts. And the book of Acts tells us, you know, it's the book of Acts, and it's actually the Acts of the Spirit. And we did that quite a couple of years ago. But Acts tells us the movement of the Spirit after Jesus had been resurrected and then ascended into heaven. John's already talked about the Holy Spirit, but then John mentions other spirits of this world. And he says you need to be warned about these spirits. You need to know they're there because they will deceive you. And not to trust every spirit. The word spirit here most likely means is primarily talking about teachers. It's, you know, it's one of those kind of things where a guy gets a good idea, he gets a little bit of teaching, the next thing you know, he wants to be a pastor, and he wants to go out there and start bringing disciples to himself. That petrifies me. I would not want to be a pastor. Because it's one of those kind of things where your ego can get the best of you, and all of a sudden, you're not listening to the Spirit of God anymore. And I speak with experience because in the 40-something years I've believed, it's not been perfect. Do I love God? Yeah. But the cares of the world and the things that happen and not being far enough along in my spiritual development, I didn't do some things right. But I'm so thankful for a God that is so compassionate. That's what John's going to tell us about. He's going to tell us about this. Because a man speaks about the Bible, God, and Jesus, it does not mean that they're a true child of God. People, they pick up the jargon. They got it down. They know what to say to tickle your ears to bring you to them. We're to test those spirits. We're to test those teachers. Not test them in the sense that we're going to, you know, pick a fight with them or something like that. What you've got to do is you've got to say, and I loved what Chuck used to say. He said, don't believe me. Go home and read it yourself. And guys, I'm telling you, it's awesome. Don't put your salvation in the hands of a person. Put your salvation in the hands of God. Let him speak to you. Test the spirits where they're of God. People profess to accept Christianity and to teach, and then they go out and teach another gospel. You must know that. I mean, I get some people, they come around, knock on your door, they want to give you some tracts and stuff like that. You talk to them for a few minutes and learn what it is that's the distortion so that you can now have a discussion about that. You want to share with them. You know, and I always thank them for coming by and talking to me. When you live by yourself, you like having somebody to come by and talk to you. They just don't know that. Okay, verse 2. John gives us an actual test. In verse 2, he gives us an actual test. He says, ask them, what do you think of Christ? Ask them what Christ is to them. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. It's not so much a confession of a historical fact. Jesus was born. He has a human body. But the confession has to be of a living person. Jesus is alive. Jesus has risen. He has gone into heaven, but he's still alive. That's what makes it so great. He conquered death. He's still living. Jesus is a living person, came in the flesh. A confession that acknowledges Jesus as Christ incarnate, he is come back. Confessing him means, this is what confessing means, doesn't mean to say I know these things, bowing to him as Lord of one's life. Presenting the Lord Jesus as the true Christ of God. You will know that he is speaking by the Spirit when he acknowledges the incarnation of Christ, that he is the Christ of God. He is the messenger from God to show us who God is. We see in Jesus, we see the Father. The Spirit of God calls on men to acknowledge Jesus Christ as Lord, and to commit their lives to him. The Holy Spirit always glorifies Jesus. Always glorifies Jesus. In verse 3, and every spirit that does not confess that Jesus has come in the flesh is not of God. False teachers, they do not confess Jesus. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, against Christ, which has been prophesied. And we have that great prophecy. In fact, that's the next thing we're going to study. We're going to study the prophecies of Revelation and what the end times are going to be like. This Antichrist, the spirit of the Antichrist, is already in the world. It's already working. There are many today willing to say acceptable things about Jesus, but they will not confess him as incarnate. They will say that Christ is divine, but not that he is God. They will deny that Jesus is God. They will say he's divine. He has a divine nature. No, he is God in the flesh. He represents the Father. Now, I think, you know, it's one of those things where we think about, okay, wait a minute. Father, Son, Spirit. The Father is eternal, infinite, invisible. The Son was God's way of doing two things, revealing himself and also saving man. That's what John's going to talk about. He's revealing God, but he's also here on a mission to save us because we cannot save ourselves. Humble believers are able to overcome because the Holy Spirit within them is a detector of errors. The Spirit will help you, will detect error, and then you refuse to listen. Verse 5, the false teachers are of the world, and therefore the source of all that they speak is the world. The world is a spring of information that they teach. Therefore, the world hears them. They speak the same language. They speak the same worldly language. They understand that. You do things with them, you start talking about Jesus, you're going to end up in trouble. But that's okay. Because what's so neat is what God has done to save us. And we need to share that with them. Approval of the world, approval by the world, it's not a test of truthfulness. You know, this is why people get into this, well, it's my truth, my truth. There's only one version of truth. There's not versions of truth, my truth, your truth. If you want to be popular, speak as the world speaks. If you're to be faithful to God, then you must face the fact the world's going to disapprove of you. John tells them that. He warns them. You may not be popular. John, in verse 6, he begins to speak rather than talking from the singular. He now speaks representing the apostles. We are of God. He who knows God hears us. All who are really born of God will accept the teaching of the apostles that is given in the New Testament. Those who are not of God refuse the testimony of the New Testament. They begin to add to or take away from or pervert. Okay, the next part that John's going to be talking about, verses 7 to 11, is knowing God through love. And God is love. So obviously it's the way in which he transmits information to us is by loving us. Verse 7, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. In this is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Verse 11, beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. The words it uses in the New King James, it uses beloved if God. It really should be, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. But you think of the two commandments, love God and love your neighbor as yourself. It's really saying the same thing. Love God, love your fellow man. But here, it's saying you're not capable of loving your fellow man without the love of God in you. Verse 7 and 8, we're going back. It's the subject of love for one's brother. That love is a duty, and it's also the character of God. John is not thinking of the love that's common to all men, but of the love to the children of God, which has been implanted. What God has planted in man, he has planted that love in us. And those who have been born again, the love of God as its origin, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. When you love God, you end up knowing God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. It does not say that God loves. God is love. Now, it is true that God loves, but John is emphasizing the point that God is that very essence. Love is God. In creating us, and this is when you begin to think about it, in creating us, he didn't just throw some matter out there, whip it up and stir it up, take a blender, and here comes us. No, he took care. He not only created us, he created a universe for us to enjoy. We see all the greatness and the holiness and the love of God in his creation. And I think people really lose a lot when they don't come at life saying, wow, look what God has done. Look what God has done. Driving across the desert, I've been going back and forth between Phoenix, and I get excited about those mountains, guys. I mean, you got these layers doing this, and you're going, why are they so nice and even, and yet they're sloping? But I'll tell you right now, you see that in terms of God's flood, is a flood that inundated the whole world, that moved soil all over the place, swished back and forth, tsunamis, everything, redepositing everything. You'll look at the Grand Canyon completely different, because it looks like a stack of pancakes. And these guys had the gall to propose that got laid down over millions and millions of years just by slow-moving water. I'm not buying, okay? You might notice that. But the thing is, look at, how do I feel about my fellow man? If I see them as a creation of God, it's hard for me to hate them. It's hard for me to be angry or to put them off, to ignore them. It makes it so much easier to love the people around you, the people in your family. You don't get the rage that you once did. Why? Because you know that same God that loves you loves them, and he's told us to love them. And we need to really open up and let God do this. He didn't say, you go get this fixed and then come back and I'll talk to you. He goes, invite me in, I'll take care of it. God is love. It's his nature. G.S. Barrett, a theologian, he's talking about these words, God is love, these three words. The greatest words ever spoken in human speech, the greatest words in the whole Bible. It is impossible to suggest, even in the briefest outline, all that these words contain. For no human and no created intellect has ever or will ever fathom their unfathomable meaning. But we may reverently say, this one sentence concerning God contains a key to all God's works and ways. God is love. We see him that way, and we see the mystery of creation. We see it differently. We see now redemption is something great. And just the very being of God, it's impossible to try to get some kind of physical construct, some way of thinking about a God that is greater than the universe in itself. He's infinite. He's everywhere. Verse 9 and 10, the manifestation of God's love is in three tenses. There's three tenses. Well, most everybody knows past, present, and future, okay? Well, the commentary I read, I thought it was really interesting. In the past, it was manifested to us as sinners. So in the past, when God did this, his manifestation of God's love was in saving sinners, dying for sinners. The gift of his only begotten Son. In the present, it's manifested to us as saints and the indwelling in us. So we go from being saved to now God is indwelling. In the future, it will be manifested to us as giving us boldness on the day of judgment. And that's what John was talking about here. Because of God living in you, because you know that he loves you, he cares about you, he's come in to sup with you, he's going to be there. On that day of judgment, he's going to take us and put his arm around us. He's going to make us feel refreshed inside as we stand there before the throne of God in judgment. First of all, we have our love, God's love to us as sinners. God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. And to be the propitiation for our sins, the covering, the payment. We were dead, needing life. We were guilty, needing propitiation. His only begotten Son, this expression, carries with the idea of a unique relationship. His only begotten Son. The only one that's come directly from the Father himself. It's a unique relationship between the Father and the Son. John writes about it all the way through his gospel. The unique relationship between the Son and the Father. This makes the love of God all the more remarkable. Sending his unique Son that we might live. God's love was not shown to us because we first loved him. He didn't show it to us when we said, okay, I'll be good. Now I love you. Okay, okay. God loves me now. No. He did not show us this. He did not do this for us because we loved him. No, actually, we were his enemies. We had broken fellowship with him. We hated him. And when I say that, I'm talking about we as a species. He did not love us because we loved him. He loved us in spite of our bitter antagonism against him. John's making this abundantly clear to these believers that it's not you. It's not what you, if you got what you deserved, there would be no propitiation for your sins. You would be on your own. You would pay for all your wickedness on your own. He rescues us. He takes his Son and he sends him to us. How did he show his love? His Son. Propitiation for our sins, covering for our sins. He paid the price. Now, finally, we're going to get a definition for propitiation. It means satisfaction. Or settling our sin debt. There had to be a price paid for the sins that man committed. We could not do it. We proved it over and over again. So what he did is he provided that sacrifice for us. He himself took on the clothing of his creation, came here, lived a perfect life, and willingly gave himself up. Some people try to think of this love of God separate and apart from the redemptive work of Christ. You can't separate God's love from redemption. It is that his love is what redeemed us. There's a paradox, and we see those from time to time, but there's a paradox between a loving God and a wrathful God. You know, and boy, I tell you what, you're talking about shaking somebody up. When I read the first chapter of Romans, I go, oh, Lord, I'm going to get the wrath of God. Oh. That wrath is coming, but not against those that believe. It's becoming against the unbelieving. That's what Paul was writing about. This love for us and this way in which he can justify us and being the propitiation, the substitute for us, it averts his wrath on us. Because of what Jesus did, it stops his wrath from coming onto us. It's powerful when we think about that. He loved us that much. You think, you know, you're going to have a deeper love for Jesus. When you read something like this, your love grows deeper. But verse 11. This is where John comes to this point where he's going to give us a lesson now on this such love. If God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. And if here does not express doubt, if the word if is not doubt, it's sense. Since God so loved us, we ought to love one another. Because these are members of his holy family that he's created. Verses 12 to 16. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him, and he in God. We abide in God, God abides in us. Verse 16, and we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. We are so secure in Christ. We are secure. And yeah, we're going to stumble. We're going to fall. But the thing is, he's right there. He dusts us off and we just keep moving. He corrects us. God's love is manifested to us in the present time by dwelling in us. The apostle says in this chapter, no one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. Perfected in us. In John's Gospel, John 1:18 says, no one has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him. In John's Gospel, we see the invisible God is made known. He's made known through Jesus Christ. But John's using the expression again, no one has seen God at any time. He's repeating in the epistle what he wrote in the gospel. No one has seen God at any time. But now God is being manifested to the world. Not through Christ, for he has gone back to heaven. He's at the right hand of God. Instead, God is now manifested to the world through us, through believers. We manifest the Father through Christ, by the power of the Spirit. We become that manifestation of God. That's why it's so important that we constantly are refreshing and taking ourselves back to the Word. It's amazing now. We must be God's answer to man's need to see Him. They need to see in us what God has done for us so they can see Him. And give our testimony, share that with people. And when we love one another, His love is perfected in us. This means that God's love to us has achieved its goal. When He loves us, we love other people, then His goal is being achieved for us as disciples. We're not terminals for God's love. In other words, I love what Chuck said one time. He says, the Spirit is like electricity. It never will go into anything it can't get out of. Hey, it still works today. I'm repeating it. But, you know, it's not a terminal. It's a channel. Another way of thinking about it. It doesn't come in to stay. The Spirit of God, the love of God doesn't come in to stay. It comes in to move through us to other people. God's love is given to us, poured out through us to others. When we do love one another in this way, that's proof that we are in Him and He is in us, and we are the partakers of His Spirit. We should pause for a minute. We should think about this for a minute. The marvel of His dwelling in us and our dwelling in Him. I remember this verse in the early years of my faith. I'm going, God's inside of me, Jesus is inside of me, the Spirit's, it's getting crowded. But you know, the thing is we always have this tendency to think that God is a distant. Jesus, you know, we read about Him, and about this Holy Spirit, I'm not sure. But the thing is, when you begin to understand that the Spirit enters us, it now enlightens us of what Jesus did for us. And so then, as John told us in his gospel, he says, the Father comes in, I come in, the Spirit comes in to dwell with you. Verse 14, John now adds the testimony of the other apostles. We have seen and testify that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. This is divine love in action. The Father has sent His Son. This is the boundless scope of Jesus. And the only thing that stops that is our unrepentant hearts, our unbelief. That's what limits God's love. That's what limits what God can do, is our obstinance, our willingness to push back, to not accept, not love, not take this as God has given it to us. Verse 15, the blessing of being indwelt by God Himself is the privilege that Jesus is the Son of God. We confess that. We confess that Jesus is the Son of God. And once again, it's not the confession of the intellectual knowledge. It's a confession that involves the commitment of one person to Jesus, committing ourselves. It's not knowing, it's what do we do with knowing. I have to ask Him to come in. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will open the door, I'll come in. He doesn't beat the door down and come in and stomp all over us. He's not waiting to hurt us. He says, behold, I stand at the door. There's no closer relationship possible. There's no closer relationship than God dwelling in us. And I really, when I'm sharing this with people, it's hard for them to understand at first. But they wonder, you know, they're struggling, they're having difficulty emotionally and stuff like that. And you're saying, why don't you come to God and ask Him? You ask everybody else, nothing's working, why don't you ask Him? And they say, well, what do you mean? Just all you got to do is say, Jesus, I believe you. Come in. Come into my heart and reveal God to me. Reveal him to me. Abide in God, God abiding in me. Verse 16, and we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him, and God is love. Love must find an object. The love is of no value going out into space. Surely he creates, but it must find an object. The special object of God's love is us, people, his creation, who have been born into the family. If I'm in fellowship with God, I must love those he loves. Verses 17, 18, and 19. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in that day of judgment. Because he is, so are we in the world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. God, the love that God has been perfected among us in this. It is not our love that is made perfect. It's God's love that's made perfect in us. God's love. It's not us perfecting our love or anything like that. It's God perfecting his love in us. This is that future time when we're going to stand before the judgment seat. We stand before the Lord either in boldness and confidence or cringing terror. The answer is that it will be with boldness and confidence because of the perfect love that has settled the sin question once and for all. It was settled when Jesus died for us and was resurrected. He died and he came back to life. The sin issue has been settled, men. The sin issue has been settled. We don't have to live in sin anymore. We can receive that forgiveness. We can receive forgiveness. That's the future. That's why when we know that we're going to be with the Lord, we know he's going to meet us and bring us into his presence. He loves us. So it will be boldness and confidence. The reason for the confidence is because as he is, so are we in this world. The Lord Jesus is now in heaven with judgment completed. He came into the world once, suffered the punishment for sins that are deserved, not for him, for us, but he takes the punishment. He finished his work of redemption. Now he'll never have to take it up again. It's done. It is finished. And that's what he said on the cross before he gave up his spirit. It is finished. He was talking about the payment for sin. And that's why he even prayed for those around him. He said, forgive them, for they know not what they do. The moment his executioners saw him give up his spirit was the moment he died for them and their sin. Guys, I mean, that's not human thinking. That's God thinking. Our sins were judged at the cross of Calvary. Just as judgment is passed for him, so we are beyond the reach of condemnation. It is over for him. He's not going to do it again. It's complete. It is also complete for us if we receive his gift. verse 18, because we have come to know God's love, we have no fear of punishment, of perishing. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. His perfect love casts out fear. His perfect love is what casts it out. Why? I'm assured of God's love. Why am I assured of God's love? First of all, he sent his son to die for me. Secondly, I know he loves me, and he indwells me presently. And lastly, I can look to the future and be confident and without fear. Fear involves torment. Truly it does. He who fears is not made perfect in love. God's love has not been allowed to operate in our lives. We have not allowed it. We hear the message. And like Pharaoh, we harden our heart. We're not allowing what he was doing. He was not allowing God to touch his heart, to minister to him. And those who are afraid, they have never come to him in repentance and received the forgiveness of sin. It's like a prisoner. Governor sends a pardon down. The warden walks in, hands it to him. You've been pardoned. He goes, no, I don't want it. He just pardoned you. I said, I don't want it. Receive it. And if you are fearful tonight, there's plenty of men here that will pray with you, that will give you that opportunity to make that open confession of faith, that you can say, yes, Lord, I know you're speaking to my heart. Come in. We love him because he first loved us. The only reason we love at all is because he loved us first. The Ten Commandments, love God, love your neighbor. But the law could not produce this love. If the law could have produced it, it would have. You cannot legislate morality. Morality comes from the inside. It comes from your heart, your desires. So, how could God obtain this love? Well, because his righteousness required it. He loves us, wants to have a relationship with us, but he can't have a relationship with us in the condition we're in. So, his righteousness required that he give up his son, that he pay the price for us. He solved the problem by sending his son to die for us. This is such wonderful love. And then what it does, if you stop and think about it, it draws our hearts out. We say, Jesus, you have bled and died for me. From now on, I will live for you. The last two verses. If someone says, I love God and hates his brothers, he is a liar. He who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? And this commandment we have from him, that he who loves God must love his brother also. The futility of professing the love of God while at the same time hating your brother, it doesn't work. It's like spokes on a bicycle. Come here, start from the outside. What do? They narrow as they move to the center. As the spokes move towards the center, they get closer to each other. As we get closer to the Lord, we have more love for our fellow believers. As you grow in Christ, you also grow in your relationship with your brothers. And we can love God no more than we do our fellow man, our fellow believers. John finishes off by explaining the impossibility of loving God whom we have not seen when we don't love our brother who we can see. John goes back in verse 21. John closes the section by repeating the commandment we have we have the command we have from God, that he who loves God must love his brother. Then chapter 5, going to next week, but it really is part of chapter 4. I'm just going to read it real quick. Verses 1 through 3, 5. Whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves him who begot also loves him who is begotten of him. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandment. Love God. Love your fellow man. There's three verses that stand out to me. John 4:4. He that is in you is greater. The one in you is greater than the one that's in the world. Satan doesn't come close to the one that lives in us. Verse 4:12. God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. And then 18 and 19. Perfect love casts out fear. We love him because he first loved us. He in us is greater. That love has been perfected. That perfected love will chase out fear as we stand before him and receive eternal life. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. It's such a blessing. And just to dig deep sometimes and just really study and just talk to other believers and learn what you have to say to us. Lord, we just thank you. We praise you for all your love, your mercy, your kindness to us through all these years. Pray now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Free my heart, set free my soul. I don't want to be a prisoner no more. Unlock the door that holds me in. This is the day that life begins.